Take a minute and greet those around you. It's halftime. Good morning. Welcome to Cornerstone. Glad you're here this morning. It's getting a little colder outside. It feels good in this warm building today. Operation Christmas Child, you probably noticed coming in, there's boxes up front here. Some people already have them packed. Collection Day is November 12th for that. And there's a little bit of reward if you decide to put a check in there to help with shipping, which is $9 now. Ron Eltz is providing homemade maple syrup. There's jars back there, so if you that's kind of your reward for helping with the shipping. So if you thank Ron, see him too, for doing that. And it takes, I know my dad makes maple syrup, and it takes a lot of time and effort and work. So thank you, Ron. Also, they don't want any candy or toothpaste in the boxes this year, so please try to avoid that. Men's Woodcutter Weekend is coming up this coming weekend, Friday night and Saturday, down at Spring Valley. Can I get a show of hands of men that think they might be going? We're just trying to get a kind of a rough count. Kind of hurting the lights on my face, but okay, thank you. And if you have questions about that, talk to Jeff or Jerry, Jeff Yoder or Jerry Hale, or you can call Danny down there too and talk to him. New group experience is going on today. We have Jonah, which is a new class starting on the book of Jonah. Kevin Smith is gonna facilitate that. It's up in room one, which is right up by the bathrooms upstairs, right after second service. And next Sunday, we have one called The Crazy Cycle, which is about marriage. And it's very similar to Love and Respect. Some of you may have done the Love and Respect class. It's similar to that, but it's much shorter. It's only 4 weeks long. Sure to be a good class. Mike Gall and the Hales, Jerry and Audrey, are going to help facilitate that. And I've got a little trailer I want to play to show you what The Crazy Cycle is all about. Again, that starts next Saturday during second service upstairs in room three. Burgers, brats, and bags, that's a men's event coming up next Sunday, 4:30 to 7. We're going to clear this area out, have a cornhole or a bags tournament right in here. And so we would love to have as many men here as possible, not only from our own church, but pull in your neighbors, your parents, your sons, whoever's around that you can pull along with you that day. We're going to have a fun tournament for about an hour, then we're going to go upstairs and eat some barbecue. That's going to be really good, and we're going to have just a real short program with it, but it's going to be a fun event. Please sign up, though. There's a sign-up sheet. I don't have a lot of names yet, but I'd like to get a bunch of names down today so we know how much food to prepare. And if you're not going to play in the tournament, but you're just going to want to come eat and just kind of come watch other people play or whatever, go ahead and put your name down anyway. Just maybe put not in tournament or something like that, but it's going to be a really fun event. And again, we'd really like you to try to invite somebody that doesn't normally come to Cornerstone along with you. You know, if you don't, if you just show up, that's okay. That's not a problem. But if you have somebody in mind, I know I have somebody in mind that I'm going to invite, for sure, to come along on Sunday afternoon. But it's going to be a great, great day for our men. Also, don't forget to set your clocks back next week. We don't want to see you showing up right as everyone else is walking out. So maybe it's the other way around. I got to think, fall back. But anyway, next week, make sure you set your clocks back Saturday night so that everybody's here at the right time on Sunday. And also have the t-shirts. Some of you ordered church t-shirts. Those will be here next Sunday for you to pick up. All right, I'd like to invite our ushers forward at this time. And if you're new here or a guest, you know, please just let the basket pass. We're happy that you're here to celebrate with us this morning. Please bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for bringing these people into your this building today to worship you and to show our honor and love for you, Lord. We are so thankful for getting Steve and Debbie back here safely. Happy that they're back here in Manchester in this house. We pray for Scotty as he's gone this weekend, that you keep him safe. We thank you for the people that are here to fill in for him, to share their beautiful musical talents with us. And just thank you for all the people that are generous, that are being generous here in this church with their time, their talents, their finances. And we just pray that you help us to continue to be generous as we give back a portion of what you've given us to help us make a difference and to honor you, not just in Delaware County, but around this world to our missionaries. And we just pray that you guide us and lead us in those efforts. In Jesus' name we pray.
Master, save my hair. have a seat.
Well, am I glad to be home. I told the guys when we were having our prayer time, it's just so good to hear English. We had a great trip, and I want to start today by saying thank you so much. First of all, I want to say thank you to the elders, and three guys in particular. Mike, who I think Mike needs like a merit badge for all-around utility player, because he leads a song, he preaches, he's... Did I do that right? Of all people who would never be that way. And then also, Kevin Smith brought the word, and so grateful that you did that. And then last week, Tom McCarthy. And thank you, guys. I've been, in terms of what researchers discover, is the single greatest fear that people have is public speaking. That's the number one fear. And just to press through that, of course, Kevin has no fear of public anything. So he didn't have a problem with that. But not everybody finds it really a pleasant experience to get up in front of lots of people and kind of expose yourself. So thank you, guys. And thank you to our family, our church family. I don't know of anybody else that in my role that has the privilege of doing what I get to do, leading here, and being able to do this whole other ministry on another continent. And I get to do that three times a year, and I'm just so grateful that you are willing to lean into kind of an innovative approach. And so thank you very much. I'm going to just give you a real quick brief slideshow of our trip. We started in Budapest this time, and this couple are directors in Budapest. Not that couple. This couple. Gonna have to keep up back there. These are our interim directors. We are currently looking for a director in Budapest, but Carol and Merrill Davis, who actually live in Davenport, right down the road from us, are our interim directors over there and are doing a great job to keep the library alive until we can find a new director. One of the disadvantages to working in Budapest is that we have to find innovative places to meet. And I don't know if you can read the coffee mug, but this is at a Budapest McDonald's, which is pretty much like the one in Dyersville, I think. Yeah, that's kind of like your average McDonald's, right? Not really. Then from there we went to Prague, and here is a picture of the Prague staff. The four on the left there, the second woman, the first woman is the director, and her spouse is right next to me. That's Lori and Jim. You'll never remember those names, but just to see them. And then a Czech who works with the library as an employee, Arena, I always say it wrong. And then our brand new member, Meredith Wins, who is a young woman, been out of college for a year, and she has moved to Prague. While we were there, she celebrated her 1 month in Prague. She's still looking for a place to live, but she's all in, and it was great being able to connect with her. One of the things that we did was Debbie got to work with the kids, and they do a couple times a month they will have events where it's just for kids, and Debbie's great at that, as I hope you know, and she was a great help with that. One of the things I got to do was some staff team building in Prague. We sat around the table and got to think strategically and work on building the team. I also got to, I don't have pictures of it, but I got to spend about 3 hours, Debbie and I got to spend about 3 hours doing team building with a YWAM team, Youth with a Mission. I think many of you are familiar with them, who are beginning their work as a prog team. And then on Wednesday night, Debbie and I got to help with a marriage class. It's a very cool thing, and I want to burn off a lot of time here, but the International Church of Prague has leased property in down in the city, which is not where they meet. They normally on Sundays meet in a Seventh-day Adventist church building out of a pretty long bus ride from the center of the city. This place where they lease, they do their youth meetings and their other meetings down there, they call the bridge. Why it's significant is because it's strategically located right across the street from Prague's biggest strip club in the red light district. There's irony in that, people. And God is at work. But we got to share the testimony of our perfect marriage. And then I did the Liars Anonymous thing after that. And that was great. And then we had 3 days just to ourselves, which we decided, since we're there, let's go do something. Pat and Chloe Coben told us about this place. It's called Chesky Krumlov, and it is really pretty. And while we were there, I want you to know, Debbie and I were in church together. Reminded us of Cornerstone. It's a beautiful place, and we were so, it was great to be able to relax. We got this great pension, which is, a hotel, and then a bed and breakfast, and then a pension. That's kind of the hierarchy, but it was really nice and pretty, and the view out the window was breathtaking. Well, I didn't realize when we booked it is if you got a breathtaking view out the window, what that means is you're up on a hill, and if you don't have a vehicle, it's no problem walking down the hill. But when you've got a half-mile hill, you got to walk up at the end of the day when you've already logged in. My iPhone tracks my steps. We've already logged in 14,000 steps, and we still got this half-mile hill to go. But it was great. I can't even thank you enough for letting us go. But I agree with Dorothy. There's no place like home. And boy, was it good to roll in on Thursday afternoon to Delhi and notice, golly, nothing changed. Imagine that. And be able to get settled back in. It'll take us a while. I don't know what time zone my circadian clock is on. I'm just sure it's not central time, but eventually we'll get there. So thank you. There's a little report. Now I'm going to race as fast as I can, because today is a significant day. We get to share communion together at the close of our service. And I don't want to cheat that time for any reason. I want to talk about the do-gooder thing today. And to talk about the do-gooder, I want to talk about two guys and two stories. First guy is Dennis. Dennis had a very unhappy and a difficult childhood. His dad abandoned the family when he was just a grade schooler. His mom moved the family to Dallas, hoping she could find enough work to keep body and soul together, and just barely did. Dennis was not a good student, and you can imagine, if you're an educator, a child coming from that kind of home environment rarely is going to be able to be a great student. There are just too many other distractions going on in his life, and he fit that mold. He got cut from his high school football team, and he quit playing on the basketball team because he wasn't getting any playing time. He's just riding the pine too much. And beyond that, he hadn't hit his growth spurt yet. But when he did, grew to be about 6'5", and he started becoming a really dominant basketball player. Went to a small college in Oklahoma, flunked out, but he got picked up by the NBA. Now, if you are an NBA fan, you probably recognize him from this picture. Dennis Rodman. He in 1993, they found him one night sleeping in an abandoned truck with a handgun. Now, if you find a guy with rainbow hair sleeping in an abandoned truck with a gun, what's your first thought? Now, add to that, this guy's making lots and lots of money. So it's not like he is homeless. Well, everybody against, I mean, he said, I'm not trying to kill myself. Really? Just sleeping with your gun for the fun of it? Well, when that suicide attempt was aborted, he decided that he would just remake himself, recreate himself, and he became a bad boy. And you probably, if you watched basketball back in the 90s, you saw him get into all kinds of fights and altercations with everybody, his own teammates, the opposing team, the referees, and probably people in the stands. It's just the way he was. In fact, he, one time, as he launched off the court into the out of bounds, he intentionally kicked a cameraman and wound up having to pay him $200,000 for a settlement. He was just a bad, bad boy. I don't know, some of you may remember, he wrote a biography, and the title is Bad As I Want to Be. And to promote that book, this is how he showed up at a press conference in a wedding dress. Can you say Dennis was a mixed up man? Had a high profile affair with Madonna, was briefly married to Carmen Electra, and recently you've seen in the headlines where Dennis Rodman has become chums with the dictator in North Korea, Kim Jong-un. Dennis is a mixed up person. I don't want any of the boys in this church to grow up to be like Dennis. I don't want any of my grandsons, I don't want anybody I know to grow up to be like Dennis. And part of that is I don't want them to have to grow up the way he did. I don't want their lives to produce what his life did. And then there's this other guy. He died in 1974, so he's not around, but his story still remains. He was a German and a very prosperous and wealthy industrialist in pre-World War II Germany. When the World War II began, actually he was one of those guys who was opportunistic enough that he seized on that opportunity and became even more prosperous. And he wasn't a perfect person, not in the least, but he was a very, very attentive and effective entrepreneur. He actually made money on the war. But as the war began to progress and he watched the Nazis begin to cleanse Germany and its other holdings of Jews, it broke his heart. So when Oscar saw what was happening, undeniably, he put his life on the line. And you may know Oscar Schindler from this picture of Liam Neeson, who portrayed him in the movie Schindler's List. This is how Oscar actually looked. This is a fair likeness. The estimates are that he's responsible for saving the lives of 1,200 Jews. During the Holocaust, 6 million Jews were murdered by the Nazis. 1,200 against 6 million doesn't even scratch the surface. But you know what? If you're the family member of one of those 1,200, or if you were one of those 1,200, that matters. If I look at Dennis Rodman and Oscar Schindler, it's an easy call who I want my grandkids to be like. I want them, between those two guys, to be much more like Oscar Schindler. When Schindler died in 1974 in Hildesheim, Germany, before he died, he asked to be buried in Jerusalem, because he said, these are my children. I kind of like that. I like the sincerity of his heart and I like that he actually did something instead of just feeling bad about bad things. And that's what we want to talk about today. We're going to take a look at Titus chapter 3, the entire chapter. So if you have your New Testament, or if there's a Bible under the most of those chairs, so grab one, turn to Titus. It's one of Paul's postcard epistles. It's only three chapters long, and it's toward the back of the New Testament. We'll also have it here on the screens. Remind the people to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready to do whatever is good, to slander no one, and to be peaceable and considerate, and always to be gentle toward everyone. At one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. But when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that, having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. This is a trustworthy saying, and I want you to stress these things so that those who have trusted in God may be careful to devote themselves to doing what is good. These things are excellent and profitable for everyone. But avoid foolish controversies and genealogies and arguments and quarrels about the law, because they are unprofitable and useless. Warn a divisive person once, and then warn them a second time. After that, have nothing to do with them. You may be sure that such people are warped and sinful. They're self-condemned. As soon as I send Artemis and Tychicus to you, I'm not a dog guy, but if I ever get a dog, I think I want to name him Tychicus, because I just think it's a good name. To you, as soon as I send Artemis and Tychicus to you, do your best to come to me in Nicopolis, because I've decided to winter there. Do everything you can to help Zenas the lawyer and Apollos on their way, and see that they have everything they need. Our people must learn to devote themselves to doing what is good, in order to provide for urgent needs and not live unproductive lives. Everyone with me sends you greetings. Greet those who love us in the faith. Grace be with you all. Amen. We're going to focus in on one aspect of this chapter. It's the aspect of doing good. There are several times when Paul writes about doing good and do-gooders in his epistles. And here's just a smattering of them. From 2 Thessalonians 3:13, Paul writes, "As for you, brothers and sisters, never tire of doing what is good." And Titus 2, chapter 2, verse 7, "In everything, set them an example by doing what is good." And then Titus 2:14, "God intends for us to be a people of his very own, eager to do what is good." And then from this chapter in verse 8, "This is a trustworthy saying, and I want you to stress these things, so that those who have trusted in God may be careful to devote themselves to doing what is good. These things are excellent and profitable for everyone." And then in verse 14 of chapter 3, "Our people must learn to devote themselves to doing what is good in order to provide for urgent needs and not live unproductive lives." I want to go back and look at verse 3 for just a minute, because it kind of sets us up to think well about what follows. "At one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another." That is a pretty thorough catalog of broad, broken life. This is a life that is run totally on the basis of win-lose. They always want to win, and they always want you to lose. And that, folks, is a zero-sum game. Even if you win, really, what did you win? Paul uses a pretty strong phrase. He says, "being hated and hating one another." To me, that sounds a whole lot like our world. That sounds like CNN. You know what? You go any place on this planet that's got a TV and you can't get away from stupid CNN. I'm telling you. Breakfast every morning. Oh, not in Chesky Krumlov. They played MTV at breakfast. I don't know which is worse. Anyway, I watch that and think this is people hated and hating everybody else. For lots of people, that's just how life is. They are in it to win it, and they are going to win at any cost. And they are not concerned about who doesn't like them and who does like them, because they're on a mission, and it's to get what they want. But you know what? That's not the mind of Christ. And that is not his design for living a productive life. Because a miracle took place, we have a whole new way of looking at life. Because we have a new mission for life. And we find that in verses 4 through 7. But when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us. Not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that, having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. I don't know of another few verses that contain as much compressed theology as that paragraph. And as tempting as it is for me to dive in and pull it apart word by word, I'm not going to do that. I just want to start it where it starts and realize that it starts with the kindness and love of God our Savior. Not the judgment and wrath of God, not even his frustration with these broken people who never want to turn their face to him. It's not about his anger with rebellious humanity. This is the prodigal God who opens his arms to the prodigal son, who embraces this son who smells like the pig pen and body odor and road dust. This is the prodigal father who throws a party because the son has come home. It's about kindness. It's about love. God did not save us because of anything we did. Not even because we came home to him. That's only our response to his mercy. So here's the thing about mercy. Mercy is, it has to be granted. But mercy does no good until it is received. God's mercy was extended when Jesus from the cross said, "It is finished." And we can know that for sure because he rose from the tomb. You see, it wasn't our effort. It wasn't even our obedience that saved us. It was God's mercy. I've said it a lot of times. My two of my favorite themes in all the Bible are mercy and grace. As a result of this new life, he has put his very own spirit in us, the Holy Spirit. In fact, Paul says the Holy Spirit is poured out on us generously. And I love that word picture. A few years ago, we got to take our Kansas grandkids up to Kansas City to the Great Wolf Lodge. Have anybody here been to the Great Wolf Lodge? It's a really upscale Motel 6 with a really neat water park indoors. And one of the things they have is this huge bucket in the water park. Got a picture of it here. And the picture doesn't do it. It's like, I don't know how big. It's way big. And I have a 3-year-old grandson who said it's 100 pounds big. It is huge, right? And it fills up with water, and then it dumps out. See, that's the word picture for how God has poured out his spirit on us who have trusted him. He doesn't do it with an eyedropper. He does it with a fire hose. I so love how God generously pours out his spirit on us. This is a picture of God pouring himself out in an extravagant measure on every believer. And the whole picture, the whole process, this whole thing, the relationship with God, It's through the grace of Jesus, and he is our hope of eternal life. We can't lose track of that. This is the reason. This is the whole motivation. This is the power for living a full, abundant, productive life that Paul is describing. It's the do-gooder life. He starts the description of the do-gooder life in the first two verses. Remind the people to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready to do whatever is good, to slander no one, to be peaceable and considerate, and always to be gentle toward everyone. Is there anybody here who does not want that to be true of them? Anybody here not want that to be their reputation? I know that sometimes I chafe at that phrase, subject to rulers and authorities, and to be obedient. I'm kind of wired as a, I'm told the term is contrarian. But really, wouldn't you rather have this as your reputation than Dennis Rodman's? Okay, I think I need to revisit a little agreement that we used to have, that when I would, you know, like ask a question like that, you don't have to say anything out loud, but if you do this, I know that means you agree yes, and this means no, you don't. Okay, so just from here forward, it's going to be helpful to me. One problem with the do-gooder life, though, is that if you're not doing it from the right motive, if you're not doing it from a pure heart, it comes across as condescension. It comes across as self-righteous. And the reason it comes across that way is because if you're not doing it with the right motive, it is those things. You'll wind up with people saying this of you. Hey, I found your nose was in my business. That's not what Paul's talking about. In verse 8, Paul says something very interesting and important about the do-gooder life. And I want to stress to you these things so that those who have trusted in God may be careful to devote themselves to doing what is good. Did you see what I'm after? Those who have trusted in God may be careful to devote themselves to doing what is good. That's big. This is a life that is built around, it's constructed around intention and thoughtful action. To be careful takes thought. To be devoted, well, it starts in your heart and mind, but it's quickly got to get out into your behaviors as well. My experience is that tons of people want to be do-gooders. I mean, I hardly know anybody that doesn't want to fit that. They want the reputation, but they just don't want to do the work, right? They're kind of like, you have to be old to remember Junior Samples. He was on the old 70s TV show, Hee Haw, and he said one time, I'd give $1 million to be rich. And that's how a lot of people are with the do-gooder life. We want the benefits without the sweat. I mean, I want to be in top shape and form. I just don't want to miss my favorite TV shows to do the work to get there. I want to learn a second language. I just don't want to have to go through the work of memorizing all the vocabulary and all that stuff. I want a world-class marriage, but I don't want to have to do all the icky stuff that it takes to have one. I want to be a super parent. I just don't. Okay, you see where I'm going with this? Most of us, I'm not going to say all of us because that'd be unfair, but most of us struggle because we want these good things, and yet we don't want them bad enough to be thoughtful and intentional. We don't want them badly enough to be careful, to be devoted. Paul says that we have to go out of our way for the do-gooder life. And sometimes we have to go a long way out of our way. You can't just make this thing up as you go along. You have to be careful. You have to think about it. You have to plan for it. And you don't quit. You don't quit when the going gets rough. This is a thing I've known about devoted people. They hunker down when things get tough. They don't skip practice. They don't give themselves a day off when getting out of bed seems like too much work, when they'd really rather just pull the covers over their head and pretend like that's an A-OK thing to do. When they know that to get where they want to go, they're going to have to get out of bed before everybody else on the block, and they're going to have to get their rear end down to the track or to the weight room or onto the field or to the practice tee or wherever it may be, even when it's inconvenient. They don't do it only when they want to. There are times when truly devoted, you can weed the truly devoted from the merely casual by asking this one question. Did you do it when you didn't want to do it? And here's another thing. Truly devoted people do it when they're scared. Do you think Oscar Schindler just waltzed his way through World War II and that saving these 1,200 Jews was no big deal to him? That he went to bed every night just feeling good about himself and the world? I think, no. Not even close. He knew that if the SS discovered what he was doing and how he was doing it, he knew what his fate would be. It'd be the same fate, essentially, as the Jews who were being taken away. And since the SS had spies everywhere, I doubt that he ever went to bed feeling really safe and comfortable. A friend of mine in recovery in Las Vegas once gave her testimony at a Celebrate Recovery meeting, and she summed up her recovery life in one phrase: do it scared. She fought fear more than any other thing in her life, and her addiction was the result of medicating that fear. So she said, I stay sober even when I'm scared. I go to my meetings even when I'm scared. I say yes to the new life even when I'm scared. It's okay to do it scared. I'd say that's true of the do-gooder life. Sometimes you have to be careful to devote yourself to doing good even when you're a little bit scared, or maybe even when you're a lot scared and your anxiety is pegging out. Even when you cannot claim a promise that says if you do the right thing, it's all going to work out right now. Because that promise doesn't exist. Don't buy the line that when you say yes to Jesus, your life is going to be happy, happy, happy. Honk if you love Jesus. You need to go back and read the book of James and 1 Peter and 2 Peter and get a glimpse of reality where those apostles made it clear doing what is right is always right, but your payoff for that may not happen in time. It may only be in eternity. Don't ever miss this. You don't have to live a do-gooder, careful, devoted life so that God will like you more. He can't love you any more than he already does. You don't get brownie points from God for being a do-gooder because God doesn't give brownie points. Here's the thing. You don't live this kind of life so that. You do it because. You don't live this do-gooder life so that God will like you more. You do it because he loves you supremely and deeply. Because you've been shown unbelievable, unmeasurable mercy by God because of the grace of Jesus. Because you've been bought back from a useless way of life, of hating and being hated. This do-gooder life is a life of grace. And that's a lot of important stuff to know. Powerful information about living the do-gooder life. But frankly, more information won't actually do what we want to do. Not just information. I don't even care what kind of information. My theory is that application is the destination for the information train. So I'm pulling the information train for the last 30 minutes or so. Now we go to the destination. And I kind of struggled with this until I realized it's not complicated. The single point of application on this is really pretty simple. The do-gooder life is about being careful to devote yourself to doing what is good. And my paraphrase of that is being thoughtful and intentional. So, I'm going to ask you this question. What one thing could you begin doing today that you sense in partnership with God's grace would move you closer to being careful, to be diligent, to do what is good? Not 16 things, not even 3 things. What one thing could you do? Could you begin doing right now? And if you want to put this whole thing on turbo, you share it with somebody, somebody close to you, but don't share it with anybody who you have known to be judgmental, because you don't need another polite police in your life. You don't need another parole officer. You need a support, an encourager. Here's the proviso, though, and it's a huge, huge proviso. This thing is because of, not in order that. Be a good do-gooder. We're going to gather around the communion tables, the back and the front here, because of the ultimate do-gooder. Because of the one who gave the ultimate good for us and to us. It's described in the passage that we just looked at. When the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, He saved us. Not because of righteous things we had done, but because of His mercy. That's what we celebrate as we take this tiny piece of bread and this little cup of juice. For us, they're the body and the blood of Jesus. This was the mercy payment. When Jesus gave Himself in this way, He bought mercy for us. And we celebrate that in this moment. We practice open communion. So any believer, any man or woman or boy or girl that has crossed the line of faith and said yes to Jesus on His terms, we invite you to join us at this table. For all of us, if you've not said yes to Jesus, this is a great moment for you to just reflect and think about the many ways God has shown you mercy. And for the rest of us, we dwell on the sacrifice of Jesus. Join me in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank You so much for how good You are to us, for Your mercy. We celebrate that today. Thank You, Jesus. Amen.
Jesus is
One of the traditions we have here that I love is that when we share communion, we also receive an offering for our caring ministry. And so give you a chance to be generous in a specific way this morning as the fellows receive this offering. And in order for that to happen, they have to like be in the back. So they're going to get the stuff. And as they receive the offering, I want to remind you of, but just let you know a couple of things. Next week, if you've been thinking about the whole being baptized thing, come on down, guys. We're not waiting for you. We want to give you the opportunity. Next week, we'll have the baptistry ready, and there will be some... you can go ahead. Just go right ahead. Baptistry. Yes, the baptistry will be filled and available. If you're interested in being baptized, all you have to do is let me know, let one of the elders know, and we'd love to help you take that step where you get to follow Jesus in a believer's baptism. The second thing, the offering, and then the baptism. And then the third thing is we have an opportunity that I want to just see if we have anybody who could help out with this. On December 7th, you know, they have the downtown in Manchester, they have the Christmas window walk and stationary parade thing. We have the opportunity, if we can, to take care of the living nativity. And I would love for us to be able to do that. But we'll need a volunteer to be at the point on that and create a team so that that can happen. If that's something kind of resonates with you, would you just tell me? Come up to me and let me know, because if we can do that, I think it'd be great. What a neat little witness to our community about the real meaning of Christmas. Okay? So, thanks so much. Would you stand with me, and we'll have a closing prayer. We love you, Jesus. We love you because you loved us first. Thank you so much for that. And as we leave this place, we want to be careful, to be devoted to doing good things as we shine the light of Christ into the world around us. Help us figure that out. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for being here.